Thank you very much.
Great. So as Dr. Mintz told you, I work on worms. But the sort of worms that I study are very different than the earthworms that you see crawling around on the sidewalk after a rain. They're much, much simpler, much smaller and more humble organisms. The worms that I study have only about 1,000 cells total. Very simple animal. And I'll show you a couple pictures of these worms. Here's a baby worm. It's just hatched out of its egg. You can see it's crawled away just a few minutes before this photo was taken. A few days later, the animal develops into an adult worm. Again, 1,000 cells. So this image was taken through a microscope. The actual size of the animal from head to tail is only about a millimeter long. And so that means that if you took a millimeter long chunk of your hair, this worm would fit comfortably inside of it. It's very simple. But nevertheless, it has a lot of characteristics that are very similar to characteristics of higher animals, even ourselves. It has a digestive tract, it eats food, has a very simple brain in its head made out of the same sort of neurons that make our much more complicated brains. And so the reason that a scientist such as myself and thousands of other scientists around the world spend all of their days studying a simple organism like this is to turn it into what's known as a model organism. A creature that's exhaustively studied, very carefully studied by scientists all over, so that we understand not only how this sort of a creature is built, but how all other creatures are built. Because all life is related to one another. We've all evolved from the same starting place. So that means that we're all made out of the same parts. This simple worm with its 1,000 cells and us with millions and billions of cells of very different types, we're all made out of the same pieces. So if we study this worm, we can also understand things about all sorts of life. It's the same way as a doghouse is made out of pieces of wood and nails, much as an apartment building or skyscraper is made. And if we study a doghouse and we understand how a piece of wood is held together by nails, we'll understand a little bit more about how a skyscraper might be constructed, even though the doghouse, in this case, a simple animal, is easier to take apart, easier to study, easier to manipulate. Now, in particular, what I'm going to be talking about today is the process of development, how we go from a single cell, a ball of goo, essentially, with no top, no bottom, no left or right, to something that's completely orderly, that has a head, arms in the right place, legs in the right place. How do we get that introduction of order to a completely disordered ball of goo? And that's the central question about development. Now, how a biologist typically works try to understand a process like development, how does the plan from head to tail get established, is to find something, find a case in which that's completely broken, and then to understand from how something's broken, how it might work normally. Now, so to make this more clear, imagine a biologist is trying to figure out what happens in a car when you press the brake pedal, why that causes the car to stop moving. A biologist's approach to this might be to try to find two very similar cars, one of which the brakes work, and one of which the brakes don't work. And then, if I were doing that, I would take apart the working car and take apart the car that doesn't work and try to understand what's different between the two cars. And I would find, maybe it's the brake cable or the brake pads or something to do with the brake pedal. I would start to understand how something works by taking a broken thing apart. And in particular, we use model organisms because it's much easier to take apart a Power Wheels little car than a Lamborghini. Much easier to understand how the basic concepts work in a simple creature, and then use that understanding to teach us how more complicated animals, such as ourselves, work in very similar ways. So for the rest of this time, I'm going to tell you about a different model organism, one that we've all seen before. This is a fruit fly, and it's one of the first creatures that scientists decided to study and study and study day in and day out to understand everything they could understand. And we've seen these guys hovering above rotting bananas and oranges. You swat them away, but if you look very closely, they're a fully functioning animal. They're a fantastic little creature. We're looking at this fly in side view. So it's got big eyes, little antenna coming out of its forehead, jaw parts for sucking up rotting fruit juice. Two wings help it fly around, the normal number of legs a little fly ought to have. And so, because scientists have been for years and years looking for different kinds of fruit flies where things go wrong, studying this little these little animals over and over again. Finally, one day, a scientist found a fruit fly that looked a little bit different. So this is the same kind of animal, but it's a mutant. And instead of having two wings, it has four wings. But everything else is normal. It grows, it reproduces all right, it can fly around with its four wings. Nevertheless, something's very wrong with this animal. Something went wrong in the process of going from an unordered ball of goo into an animal that has all the parts in the right place. Something happened to cause a new part to or to cause a part to get repeated. And so that's interesting. That tells us something about how parts might get put in the right place during a process of development. Alone, it doesn't tell us enough, but it turns out that this is just one of many different kinds of fruit flies that scientists found that have the right parts, but in the wrong places. So here's another picture. This is a side view of a fly. Here we're looking at the fruit fly head on from an electron microscope, which is a very powerful microscope. And you can see again, it's got its two eyes. Here are the antenna coming out of its forehead, and then its jaws for sucking up the fruit juice. This is a completely normal fly. But scientists found a different fly where instead of antenna, it's got legs coming out of its forehead. Now, can you imagine that? Legs coming out of its forehead? Everything else is normal. These legs work. They look like legs ought to look. They're just not where legs ought to be. And that's not the only place that you can get legs where they ought not to be. So here we've got them coming out of the forehead. In this animal, this fly not only has legs coming out of the forehead, but it's got legs coming out of its jaws, too. So this is, you know, kind of crazy, kind of gross. but it also tells us something about how the organismal development happens. And what it tells us is that there is some process by which the developing organism says, all right, it's time to make a leg. And if that process happens at the right time, in the right place, the leg comes out of the right place and grows properly. But that process can also be messed up in some way so that you get a completely normal leg in the complete wrong place. It's almost as if there was some sort of series of dominoes where if you push the domino over at the right time in the right place, all of the little steps necessary to build a leg happen and you get the right leg. If you push it over at the wrong time or build all your dominoes up in the wrong place, you'll still get the right cascade of everything falling down to make a leg, but just a little bit wrong and in the wrong place. So over many years, scientists began to understand exactly what these dominoes are. In particular, as you've studied, you know that proteins are the molecules and cells that cause things to happen. And there's a class of proteins, each that show up in different places at different times during the development of the animal, from this ball of goo into something that has structure from head to tail, called HOX proteins, H-O-X, in case you want to look it up on Wikipedia afterwards. And in particular, different kinds of these HOX proteins show up at the right time, at the right place, to cause, to turn on more proteins, that turn on other proteins, that bring all of the machinery necessary together to make a wing at the right place. However, if one of these HOX proteins shows up at the wrong time or in the wrong place, you get another wing, an extra set of wings, where it doesn't belong. So this is really interesting because it tells us something about how development happens. Now let's imagine that you're trying to design a building. You're an architect and you're designing a house. And you might have a basic high-level blueprint that says, all right, I'm going to put a kitchen here, a dining room here, and a living room here. And you might not specify, you might not put all of the details about the kitchen on that first blueprint. It might be for kitchen, see page, you know, for details about where the stove goes, see page 17. And so you can imagine that a tiny typo on that first page of the blueprint might lead you to having two kitchens, see page 17 over here and see page 17 over here. Tiny typo leading to a complete mess as the builders come in and are just following the broken blueprints. The same thing happens here. This protein usually says, all right, to build a wing, see page 17, and then follow the procedure thereon. sometimes there's a little typo and you get that second set of wings. But the wings get built correctly.